we making an official Tampa Bay Pittsburgh under bet? Because that's the last game on Sunday. I think that's an official bet, Bill. I think we have to do that. They're going to be slipping and sliding all over the place. Nobody's going to have any footing.
I'll take it. Who's the favorite of that game?
Tampa's the favorite.
Over Pittsburgh?
Yeah.
I say we take the points and what's Pittsburgh's nickname?
The Maulers.
Well, that's great. I'm taking 3.5 in the Maulers on that game, and we'll take
the under.
Under
42.5.
To me, that's a 2017 win. They're playing Tampa. That's a 2017 win for Tampa, but I'm taking the 3.5 to get the cover, and we're going under.
Done.
Put in the book.
Done.
We're done.
And that's how you handicap the USFL. Alan, I'm looking at the receivers, and this year's class is kind of reminding me a little bit of last year's in the sense that I feel like you have your top three guys with Garrett Wilson, Drake London, Jameson Williams. Last year, we had Chase Waddle and Devontae Smith, and then there's kind of a drop-off. So of those big three, who is your favorite of Wilson, London, and Williams, and which guy do you think could have kind of that Ja'Marr Chase just breakout rookie season? I love this game, Bill. I love this game from a betting perspective. I think this is the kind of game where if you like a team, it's going to correlate with the total. So I did some digging. I thought about it. Our initial reactions when we saw that Atlanta was going to beat Charlotte last night, we figured the spread would be right around 1-2. It was 1.5 last night. It's jumped up to 2.5. We both said we didn't want the 1.5. We'll just take the Hawks' money line. I think I'm going to stick with it, swallow the -140. But I was looking at Trae Young and the Hawks and how they did versus the Cavs. We noted on his struggles against Charlotte.
Yep.
Trae Young this season against Cleveland. Atlanta went 3-1 against the Cavs this season. In those three wins, Trae Young had 41 points, 35 points, and 30 points. His over-under prop for tomorrow, 29.5. In their only loss to the Cavs this season, Trae Young only had 20. In those three Hawks wins, the total combined points, 238, 239, 240. Tomorrow's total,
222.5.
I mean, that's a lot right there. The loss this season, the game that Cleveland won, 101.95. The Cavs won 196 total points. So you can see, if the Hawks are going to win this game, it's going to be high scoring. If the Cavs are going to win this game, it's going to be low scoring. I understand regular season basketball is different than postseason basketball. We've been touching on the unders in this play-in game. But I think if you like the Hawks, this is a spot where I like the over. Especially in those three Hawks wins, the fact that they scored near 240, and this is 222.5. We saw them hang 132 on the Hornets. For me, I think this is a parlay situation. Atlanta money line, the over, and Trae Young's over point total. All three of those, I think that's a really solid
is
play.
There
reason I love the O-line play so much, whichever guy you want to go with. Look at Jacksonville's offseason, right? They bring in Brandon Scherff from Washington.
Right.
They bring him on the O-line. You pair him with Cam Robinson as a tackle, Scherff up the middle. Evan Ingram's now the tight end in Jacksonville. Christian Kirk is now a wide receiver there. Travis Etienne comes
back after
he missed all of last year. So you have a couple skill guys. You bring in another O-lineman. And now you have a chance to really solidify your line, give yourself three cornerstone pieces up front, and you're going to go defensive end. I get it to have two great pass rushers, but there's just a lot of sense to be made for going O-lineman. That's why at 12-1, I think it's pretty good value because there's still a lot of time between now and when the draft kicks off in a couple weeks. A lot of different conversations could be had. Do you remember the year Baker Mayfield went 1 when that was kind of a shock that day?
Right.
That morning, the odds kind of jumped in his favor. But up until then, he wasn't thought of to be the number one pick. Maybe this draft is kind of the same way. But I think it's worth taking a little shot at one of the old linemen 12-1 because looking at Jacksonville's offseason, building the offense the way they did, I think it makes sense that they bring in an offensive lineman. Celtics and Brooklyn and Philly and Toronto. I feel like Toronto and Brooklyn are going to be very trendy picks by people to win those series outright. Are you going to be one of those people? Do you like Toronto? Do you like Brooklyn? Or do you think that the Celtics and the Sixers advance and move on? Correa was public enemy number one. He wore that target on his chest. He thrived off it. He was unbelievable in the postseason. I think Brett Bregman's got to be that guy. I know Altuve's the one that everybody wants to hate. Bregman's kind of getting that hatred too, but he's the dude with all the talent that his guys can look at. He's been there long enough where he's got to take that Correa role, and if he does that, the Astros can get back to another ALCS. To me, he's the whole wild card.
Looking at props, I'm interested. You know, in the NFL for playoff season, I really like betting QBs to go over their rushing yards because I just feel like in a regular season game, they might throw the ball away, but in the playoffs, they'll fight for those extra 2 or 3 yards. When you're betting NBA playoffs and you're looking at props, whether it be points or assists or rebounds or whatever you want to bet, is there a certain way that you bet the NBA playoffs differently than you might bet the regular season?